Welcome to RLF Radio, the only show that helps young baseball players and their parents prepare for high school athletics and beyond. Brought to you by the Ryan Lemon Foundation, with your hosts, Dick Owens, Guy Lemon.
Good evening, everybody. This is Guy Lemon from the Ryan Lemon Foundation, and my cohort tonight is the infamous Dick Owen. Dick, thanks for being here.
Hey, it's great to be here. We got a great guest today. Everybody should be listening to this one, I guarantee you.
Yeah, this one will be of interest to anyone from who are 7 or 8 years old on up through actually young adults and adults and parents as well. We'd like to introduce a gentleman that's currently been with the Angels organization, the Los Angeles Angel organization, for the past 5 years in their fitness training thing on the minor league side. We'd like to introduce you to Adam Auer. Adam, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me, gentlemen.
And I know right now with your season kind of coming into a quiet time, we appreciate you taking the time. You've just been off a vacation up north, and so we appreciate you being here to kind of help people out. And specifically, I guess we'll
Unfortunately, it's vacation time for them.
Yeah, well, that's true. Yeah, we should be in the playoffs. Yeah, but be that as it may, for everybody, Adam's background, and I'll let you kind of describe your background, but he's everything about physical fitness. So, Adam, why don't you start by just telling your professional background, education, and then what you're currently doing for the Angels as a reference point to all the questions we're going to be talking about.
Sure. I grew up in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. I played baseball and basketball as a kid growing up, but I was fairly specialized in baseball. You know, basketball was just kind of a hobby, something to take up some time in between baseball season and kind of bridge the gap. But I ended up playing college baseball at Saracoso Community College. It's a small junior college in Southern California. And then I went on to play at a four-year school, CSU Pueblo, which is Division II in Southern Colorado. There I got my BS in sociology and exercise science. And I also got a K through 12 teaching certificate, but throughout college and whatnot, I always helped out coaching baseball at the youth levels, running camps, and you know, kind of always had my hands in on the strength and conditioning aspect of the athletes that I was coaching as well. So that was always of great interest to me. Yeah, and as of 2013, I started my current position with the LA Angels. In those 5 years, I've worked my way up to our double-A position. So last year, I was in the Texas League, and this year we switched affiliates. So I was in the Southern League in Mobile, Alabama.
I know I thought it was interesting when we had a chance to talk earlier and just about your background, that the Angel organization has a strength and fitness coordinator for each minor league club, and then an overarching coordinator of all strength and conditioning from the major league level on down. Just touch on that for a minute. I mean, because I think what's relevant is to realize for people listening the degree by which the Angels and other major league teams invest in the process of strength and conditioning. They don't expect players to do it on their own. They expect to have trainers. So just touch on that for a minute, the breadth of the Angels' commitment to strength and conditioning.
Yeah, I think in kind of overarching to that is the commitment from Major League Baseball, you know, and over the last 10 years especially, we've seen a great increase in the number of strength coaches, having a strength coach at every level, having a minor league coordinator, a big league strength coach, and having just all of those opportunities available for the athlete during the season. So we have our big league strength coach, an assistant strength coach to the big league guy, and then we have a minor league strength and conditioning coordinator or performance coordinator, and then at each of our levels, AAA, AA, High A, or Advanced A, Low A, and both of our rookie ball positions, we have a strength coach at those affiliates. So it's really of a benefit to the player to have that with them all year round.
And just as a reference point, Adam, you travel with that team, right? So if it's a double-A team or triple-A or whatever it might be, you're going with them everywhere they go play, right? So you're traveling on a bus,
everywhere.
And you guys don't take many plane rides, I wouldn't think. but maybe
not in
few.
Double A.
Not double A.
In double A, we use the bus, and it's anywhere from, you know, a 45-minute commuter to an 8-hour trip north up to Tennessee. You know, so I get to ride on all the bus rides.
See, it's fun stuff. See, if kids and parents don't realize what it is like in the minor leagues. It's a little bit different than what we see on TV.
Well, and we could probably spend a whole session just telling stories about what happens between and after the games and the bus rides, but that'll be for another day. You know, and this probably will get us into the detail, just as you described the commitment, the financial commitment, and the manpower commitment at the professional level. Obviously, most of our listeners are high school kids and junior high kids that are trying to move on. Some high schools have a strength coordinator. Other high schools don't. Some players are trying to get into high school and may not have access to any training. So we hope in tonight's discussion we're going to orient things on the one hand to let people realize what is happening at the professional level in terms of the commitment to strength and conditioning, and then also try to reference it back and take advantage of Adam's knowledge and apply things irrespective of your personal financial circumstance, whether you have access to a gym, you may not, whether you have access to a personal trainer or a fitness coach at the high school level. Hopefully the information you get tonight will be applicable at several levels. And that's probably a good place to start. I know we break it down between preseason, in-season, and after-season. We're right now at the high school and junior high level. We're in the preseason mode, even though really gets more involved in preseason in the January, February. What things, if these questions are predominantly oriented to the high school player and the junior high player, in that regard, what things would you describe are important for guys to be doing in the off-season in this preseason preparation between now and, say, February when baseball in California gets going and through most of the Sun Belt states across the nation? What do you think are the kinds of things that guys should be focused on in this preseason time period?
Well, I think that, I guess currently, I would say we're kind of postseason, preseason. I would hope that, you know, if the season kind of ended around the same time our minor league season ended, which would be August, that those kids take some time to be kids, you know, and really enjoy the off season or the transition into preseason, and really take the opportunity to just be active, you know, whether they're walking, hiking, biking, swimming, you know, whatever it is that they're kind of getting out of the movement patterns that they had been so deeply entrenched in for the season.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, and the one thing here, and we've noticed at least in California and it's across the nation as well, schools are starting earlier, so we've got kids now going back to school in mid-August. You know, and they've just finished their summer ball basically the end of July, so they have like 1 or 2 weeks these days to even do anything, and it's really difficult.
So if it's an off-season kind of environment, would you say the focus, and again, to the high school player and so on, should be to the degree that he wants to work out after taking a break and just, you know, kind of being a teenager, to focus more on cardio, to focus more on weight training? And I know specifically when we get into weight training, there's a lot of different ways to do weight training, and then nutrition. Touch on all three in the off season. Where do you think the emphasis ought to be between cardio, strength, and nutrition? What's your thoughts in those three categories?
Sure. I think that once you've kind of had that time to be a kid and kind of decompress and you're starting that preseason preparation, we've generally started into it's called general physical preparedness. So we're focusing on more work capacity and an increase in rep ranges, more so endurance-based capacity. And at this stage, we're trying to expose the athlete, again, to as many movements in all planes as possible to kind of reinforce the technique of the basic rudimentary movements that we're going to be using later on. So if we can put together the pieces, we would work on, you know, kettlebell swings and rack pulls above the knees, below the knees, all preparing to towards the deadlift, or lunge work, forward, backward, step ups, to prepare ourselves, and then to a goblet squat to prepare ourselves for the squat movement, which would be coming later on in the subsequent months.
Okay, well, let's break that down, because I recognize some of those terms, but a lot of people may not. So do you think, just on the cardio side, would you say guys should be working on sprints, running longer distances, not at all? Is that just sort of cardio is just a baseline? Let's just talk just cardio for a minute.
Okay, just cardio. Cardio is difficult for us as far as baseball work goes, because we don't necessarily work aerobic capacity. It's a very anaerobic sport, but I believe that, you know, being able to walk, whether it's on an incline treadmill, pairing that with some feet elevated stretching and circuit training for regeneration.
Let's break that one down. Circuit training regeneration. Give me that in layman's terms.
Circuit training regeneration. So we would just pair multiple exercises and complete them sequentially, rather than focusing on just the dumbbell bench press or just the squat. We would have multiple exercises.
Where you go back to back to back to try and raise the heart rate?
So we would try to get that heart rate between 120 to 150 beats per minute to condition the heart. The heart's a muscle as well, and we want to be able to condition the heart. But for us, in baseball, since it's such an explosive sport, you're going from swinging a bat to sprinting 90 feet. You know, we want to make sure that when we are conditioning, I guess, that it's specific to what we're trying to attain in the goals of sport. So we would work on more short burst accelerations and things of that nature.
So, as an example, if on this cross training, curls and triceps. I mean, I think everybody knows what a curl is. Every guy knows what a curl is. That's the guns you want to show off, and the tricep is going the other way, and a shoulder press and a chest press. Would you do those four as an example, one exercise, and then the next, and do those four, and come back and do a second circuit? Would that be the way to do it, or do you do three sets of 10 reps of a curl, and then do three sets of 10 on the try in that regard to just getting your heart rate up? How would you do that?
During that preseason, when we're trying to reset, I would generally try to group multiple exercises together rather than just focusing on one specific exercise.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So I wouldn't do three sets of 10 on my bicep curls or my chest press. I might have a reverse lunge paired with a kettlebell swing paired with a chest press and some sort of rowing.
Now, the kettlebell is the actual bell, correct?
Full body circuit. Pardon me?
I'm sorry. The kettlebell is the actual bell that you would buy at a store, right?
Kettlebell.
Right. Because some people may not know what that is. And you would buy, there's different weights on that, of course, that you can buy.
Correct.
And again, that mechanic, again, for people that don't know, you kind of, you're standing up, you spread your legs apart, you bend at the waist, and it's
a hip hinge.
And then you're swinging it out in front of your body from behind your legs on the ground and kind of thrusting your hips forward.
Correct.
We're trying to
get some posterior chain activation, so our glutes and our hamstrings, and then we're working into that hip extension. So we're really focusing on squeezing the glutes as that kettlebell raises from between our legs up towards our midsection.
And does this hold true, Adam, pretty much for whether you're a pitcher or an outfielder or infielder? Are this exercise is pretty much the same, or they vary by position?
As we get more specific into athletic abilities,
right,
as far as position-wise goes, I wouldn't necessarily have a catcher doing the same exercises as an outfielder.
Right.
I mean, they would be doing many of the same exercises, but there may be a different focal point
right.
for each of them.
Okay.
Well, what would be the generalized differences between, say, a catcher and an outfielder? I mean, I assume infielders sort of fit within the line of, or is that a third category? Infielders, outfielders?
Yeah, that would be a third category.
To generalize, how would you generalize the differences between those three position types?
I would generally look at, you know, a catcher is down in a squat position. They quite often sit in that. I mean, they sit in that position for the whole game. I mean, aside from getting up. So you think about the number of squats that catcher actually does. Even though they're unloaded, they're still squatting possibly, you know, 140 times a game, 150 times a game.
So a much greater emphasis on squatting and that rep to be able to
your
do
glutes
that.
And hamstrings, right?
Right. So I might train a catcher a little bit differently and focus on more hip extension exercises rather than hip flexion, because when they're in that squat position, they're in a hip flex position. So quite often their quads, hip flexors, psoas, all part of that anterior chain is going to be more active than the posterior chain. So we want to maybe focus a little bit more. Again, it's going to be fairly similar to what an outfielder is doing, but we would focus a little bit more on posterior chain work in that hip extension motion.
Posterior, that's the back side of the body.
Correct.
Do I have that backwards? Posterior is...
It's one of those sides.
One of those. I know it's either front or back.
Yeah.
I had a 50-50 chance
you
of getting
a
it
shot
right.
At it.
Let's go back one step. Stretching. I've heard the term static stretch, active stretch, and dynamic stretch. Are those the correct terms? And for anybody that doesn't know what those are, if I got them right, can you explain the differences and then why you do one versus another and when do you do them? Before you work out, after you work out? Because I assume stretching is a very important integral of strength and conditioning. Speak to the whole concept of stretching in those three terms.
Stretching is definitely important, but we want to make sure that the tension of our muscles isn't lost. So it's very important to have tension within that muscle. So if you sit in a static stretch position over and over and over again, we lose that length tension relationship. We want to kind of keep some tension in there. So generally I would say that before your training, we would use SMR, which is self myofascial release, which
okay, put that into layman's language. What does that mean?
Foam roll.
Okay, and for those that don't know, that's anything that just kind of rubs across the arm, and it would be something, a foam roll that literally is like 6 inches around, probably 3 feet in width,
right.
And you roll the muscle over it. And the purpose behind that is to do what? It breaks down the muscle fiber?
Yeah, we're going to just break up tissue that has become locked down and could possibly inhibit the range of motion. So if you feel like you have a knot in a certain spot on your quad, you might roll over it for 30 seconds to a minute to try to break up that tissue a little bit so it moves a little bit more freely.
Got it.
So foam rolling, and obviously that's not it. And then you would go into some kind of stretching? And again, all of this is pre-workout?
So you can use a foam roll or a lacrosse ball if you need to trigger point a little bit more acutely. And find that one specific spot that's really bothering you.
And again, for those that don't know, that's something that's like a racquetball, only it's harder.
Yeah. Right.
And you sit on it or lay on it or put it up against a wall.
Crossball, baseball, softball, and whatever you have available.
Yeah, and you roll on that, and it really isolates the area that's sore and tender. What about static stretches versus dynamic and active stretch? How do you guys differentiate those? Do you use all three? Do you use one? What's your?
I would generally use a static stretch post lift. So after you've stressed the tissue and it's contracted, you want to put a little bit of length back in it and kind of relax the tissue. And then as far as dynamic stretching, dynamic movements, We generally do those before you could do that before a lift. We generally do it before we go onto the field for a baseball activity. So that would be like our A skips and our bounds and any sort of dynamic movement. We generally try to keep our stretches pre-baseball activity to around 10 to 12 minutes and just keep the athletes moving, increasing that heart rate and kind of preparing their body for the baseball activity ahead.
Well, you know, it's one thing, and Adam, we're running out of time, and I want to follow up with a couple of questions, and then are you able to come back next week? Is that because we've got a lot more stuff we'd like to go over? Are you available yeah. next week to chat some more?
If you want me back, I'd be glad to.
Absolutely, we want you back.
Yeah, we haven't even gotten through half of the page of questions, but just to finish the stretching thing, tell me what define what a static stretch is. I think I know, but I want to just make sure the listeners understand what a static stretch is as compared to a dynamic stretch.
That would be just, you know, sitting on your bottom and reaching to your toes and just staying statically in that position. So you're not moving.
For 10 seconds, for a minute, for 4 minutes, what is there a magic time? Because I would assume it's more than 10 seconds, and a couple of minutes is probably better than 10 or 15 seconds. Am I right, or...?
Yeah, we would generally stay in positions for anywhere from 30 seconds to a minute.
Okay. Because I know that most young kids, parents, it's like, oh, you know, I'm 12 years old, I'm limber as heck. But I suspect that what you're saying is it's still stretching is a very important component of the whole weightlifting strength training process.
Sure. Absolutely.
Well, I know what we'd like to do when you come back next week is get a little bit more into some of the in-season stuff and then talk a little bit about weight training specifically, things like every kid wants to go, you know, gee, I maxed out on my bench press. You know, low number of reps, high weights as against high reps, low weights. Why do you do one versus another? And then fundamentally lifting begins. I don't want the answers now because those are some of the things we're going to go over because I've seen people.
And nutrition.
Gym,
we didn't get into that.
And nutrition.
I want to go through a little bit of that.
And hydration and sleeping. So because I know on the lifting, I see guys lifting and they grunt and they groan and they lift it three times and then they're done. And I'm guessing you're going to suggest that may not be the right thing, that the mechanics are important. So. With that, Adam, I appreciate you being here. Adam is the strength and conditioning coordinator for the Los Angeles Aimers in their minor league program. Thank you very much for being here, and we'll arrange to have you back next week, Adam. So, again, thank you very much for being here.
Thanks for having me, gentlemen. I appreciate it.
No problem.
And with that, everyone, this is Guy Lemon and Dick Owen signing off for the Ryan Lemon Foundation. And as we will remind you every week, keep swinging for the fences. Thank you.